Right, so today we will look at the fluid magnet analogy in a little more detail, and I'll introduce the so-called mean field critical exponents. So just to recall to you quickly what we had said, we said if you have a collection of spins, each of which can point in one of two directions, up or down in the simplest case, then we had a simple formula for the magnetization in an applied magnetic field H, and the magnetization per particle, I denoted it by M, and this quantity was equal to tan hyperbolic mu H over K Boltzmann T, where mu is the magnetic moment, magnitude of the magnetic moment of each particle. Pardon me? I defined it as M over M mu. Yeah, it was equal to this. And now, of course, we can plot this M versus H diagram. So here's H, here's M. And it runs from between minus 1 and plus 1 in this fashion. And the isothermal susceptibility, which is the derivative at zero field out here, this quantity chi t was equal to delta M over delta H at constant T. At H equal to 0, this quantity was equal to mu over K Boltzmann T, which is proportional to 1 over T, which is the Curie law for paramagnets, right? Now, the question is, how are you going to include interaction between these various magnetic moments leading to the phenomenon of ferromagnetism itself? But while we do that, and I'm going to do that in a theory called the mean field theory, let me qualitatively draw graphs and show you what the actual results are so that you can see immediately where we are headed for. Okay. And the graphs are as follows. Again, the so-called fluid magnet analogy. Which said that for a fluid, you had P versus V, and these isotherms were things like this, below the critical point, and then you had a critical isotherm of this kind, and above the critical point, you had things like that. So this point, this inflection point, is VC, PC, and of course, for TC. So this is T equal to TC isotherm. That's one thing. Corresponding to that, we have the M versus H diagram here in this fashion. So this region above TC corresponds to these isotherms here. Okay. Then let me just say what the result is. This critical isotherm, T equal to TC, with an inflection point, corresponds to what's called a critical isotherm here, like this, and this is for T equal to TC. This is for T greater than TC. Just as this is for T greater than TC, and this is for T less than TC. Okay. Of course, you immediately see a difference, which is that while the pressure here at the coexistence region changes with the temperature, that doesn't happen here. They're all at the same point here. And now you can ask, what happens if you go below TC for this system here? This model will not show anything because it's equivalent to the ideal, classical ideal gas. In other words, there is no phase transition. PV equal to RT, there's no condensation because there's no interaction between the molecules assumed. The moment you put in interaction between molecules, then condensation can happen if there's an attractive interaction. And there is, we know in real life, an attractive interaction at long range, and that's what is responsible for this condensation below TC here. The same thing happens here, and we'll see this explicitly. What happens actually is that you come till here, and then you discontinuously jump out here. So this is an isotherm, this thing here, for T less than Tc. And all the isotherms for T less than Tc are of this kind. They have a discontinuity on the H equal to 0 line and they jump down. So in a sense, all these points, these flat portions are all compressed onto one line, okay, in this case. So this is the connection between those two fellows. Now you can ask, what's the susceptibility? Well, I defined it, delta M over delta H at H equal to 0. You could ask, is there a susceptibility in the ferromagnetic phase? Now, why do I call this the ferromagnetic phase? Because even when I switch off the field, there's a remnant magnetization. That's the characteristic of a ferromagnetic phase. So if I switch off the field from the positive direction, at that temperature, the system will show this magnetization. But if I switch it off from the negative direction, from opposite sense of the field, it would show this value here. Okay. Just as out here, if I decrease the pressure to this point, you would be here. If I decreased it on the gas phase, you would be here, in exactly the same way. So it looks like the analog of the liquid phase and the gas phase here is, it has more symmetry. It's a magnet with the magnetization positive versus a magnet with magnetization negative here. The analog of the fluid homogeneous phase out here is the paramagnetic phase when there's no magnetization at all. Now this becomes, yeah.
It seems like the thermal noise suddenly starts doing something when the temperature is less than Tc.
Yeah, so we'll have to see what this Tc is and what the difficulty is. We're going to see this in some detail, okay? What happens is, in a nutshell, his question is, does thermal noise start doing something at Tc or below Tc? And the answer is yes. It's the other way about. The interaction tends to align things. Beyond a certain temperature, the disorder effect wins and the ordering effect does not. That's essentially, in a very crude way, what happened. There's always thermal noise present, thermal fluctuations. The typical strength of a unit of thermal fluctuation is, in energy units, is kT. Now, if the characteristic energy associated with ordering is much less than kT, then you're in the so-called high temperature regime, which is disordered. And if it's small compared, if it's large compared to kT, then of course you are in the low temperature regime, okay? So ultimately, as we'll see today, the strength of the interaction decides where this critical point, where the critical temperature is. There's always thermal noise, of course. Many other crazy things happen at the critical point, and that's why it's so hard to understand in elementary terms. One of the things that happens is, and this is the modern way of understanding, the correlation length of the system diverges at the critical point, and we'll in fact establish that. We'll see how it diverges today. Okay. So this picture has to be kept in mind, the PV and the M versus H. Then the next one was, in the fluid case, we had the fluid I'm doing here, so we had the T here and we had P, and remember that this was liquid, this was gas, and this is the critical point. So this point is Tc, this is the critical pressure Pc. Okay. The question is, what's the analog of that here? I've already said that the two phases, liquid and gas, correspond to magnet up and magnet down in this case, and the fluid phase above the critical point, the critical region, corresponds to a single phase there, the one phase region, corresponds to the paramagnetic region here. So what does the analog of that graph look like? Well, it's like this, and I'll draw it here. Of course, there P and T are non-negative, so only the first quadrant is involved. But here, you certainly have P will run all the way from 0 upwards. But M, of course, can be positive or negative. H can be positive or negative as a function of this field. And the question is, what is the analog of the PT curve? It's got to be the H versus T curve here. Okay. So what do you think is the analog? Well, let's remember what happened here. We know that the slope of coexistence line dp over dt equal to delta s over delta v. By the Maxwell relation, okay. And then I argued that generally delta V between vapor and liquid is very, very large. So you have a large denominator and the slope is very small in magnitude. It's also always positive because if that stands for S entropy of gas minus entropy of liquid divided by volume of gas minus volume of liquid, specific volumes, then both numerator and denominator have necessarily to be positive. And the slope is small. Here the same thing happens, but now you have the symmetry between up and down. Whatever you got here with a certain switching off the field here, exactly the same thing with the minus sign appears here. This is reflected here in this. It's completely symmetric. You can see in this graph that if you change the sign of H, you change the sign of M. So it's completely symmetric in this situation. Therefore, this graph has no choice but to be a straight line here. It cannot be in any particular direction because if it were up, it would violate this up-down symmetry. So it's got to be like that and then at T, critical. And that's the coexistence line between a phase which is not liquid but ferro up. Let me just denote it by this, and this is ferro down. And on this side, just as you have a homogeneous fluid phase out here, on that side you have the paramagnetic phase. So you already see by symmetry that the slope here, dH over dt of the coexistence curve must necessarily be zero. Okay. Right? I just argued this by words saying that look, whatever happens up here when we reverse the sign of the field, the magnetization changes and it's got to be so. But we can now ask, no, let's just blindly apply the Clausius-Clapeyron equation. Let's just blindly apply the analog here. Then why should it be 0? dH over dt, that graph must have a slope which is delta S divided by delta what? What's the analog of the volume? The magnetization, delta M. And if this is 0, what does it mean? Well, delta M is finite because this is M for zero field and this is M from the negative side. So delta M, the denominator, is finite. It's this difference out here. But the numerator is zero because how, after all, do you get this graph? How do you get a point here? You have a specimen like this in which everything can point only up or down. Then if this is, remember, this is an average magnetization over the whole sample. So it's clear that if you were at absolute zero of temperature, you applied a field, infinitesimal field in the up direction, everything would align in the up. You'd be here. Similarly, if you applied a negative field, you'd be here. The reason you have this gap here that has not gone all the way up there is because of thermal noise, thermal fluctuations. So what you have is large islands of up, 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 and then there are smaller regions of down, down, etc. As you bring the field down towards zero, this on the average there will be more pointing up than down and you have a net up magnetization. As you lower the temperature further, it takes less and less field in order to align. So you're going, this intercept is going to move up. Ditto for the other side, move down towards minus one. Now it's clear by this symmetry that the entropy of the system, which is a measure of the disorder in the system, is equal on both sides, because whatever domains you had here for upfield and down domains in the upfield, exactly the opposite happens in the case of a negative field. So these would become down and these would become up here. So it's not surprising that the entropy is zero, change in entropy is zero. The moment that happens, the slope here has to be zero, because the denominator doesn't vanish, the numerator vanishes by this symmetry. Okay, so that's a rigorous argument that this curve, coexistence curve between up and down, has to be flat here. It's a good thing it's flat, because you see, otherwise look at what will happen. Out here, if I start with a liquid at atmospheric pressure, say, and I heat it, I increase the temperature, it will boil once you cross 100 Celsius. So it will go across, so it will certainly boil, because you can go across this line out here. You could also get it into a gas form by dropping the pressure down this way, or anywhere across which cuts this line here. On the other hand, if you start here with ferro up and you just increase the temperature, it's going to go up like this. It's not going to transform into a magnet down without changing the field. You have to change the field to do that. On the other hand, you can boil water, you can boil water, it becomes gas without changing the pressure, but you cannot make an up ferromagnet, down ferromagnet without changing the field, just by increasing the temperature. So that itself tells you that this graph has to be flat by symmetry.
But the analogy with that is really for para to ferro, which we are going to discuss.
We are now going to talk about para to ferro. That's a different matter out here. What's going to happen here? For that, I need the third of these graphs. And the third graph was, of course, in this case, it was the density. T versus rho graph, and it was roughly like this. This was the coexistence region, this here was the gas phase, this is the liquid phase, this is the critical point. Okay. And this region was a coexistence region. In the van der Waals isotherms, if I quench something suddenly to a point here, it would phase separate into a part liquid and part gas, saturated vapor above it. And the exact ratio of how much happens can be found by so-called lever rule, which I'm not getting into here. But the fact is, the two coexist here. On the other hand, there's no coexistence region here at all, because let's look at what the analog of that graph is. So on this axis, I draw temperature. I draw magnetization here, and since M can be plus or minus, I draw this. Okay. Then here is TC, first let's look at what happens if I have zero field. Then depending on whether I switch it off from above or from below, above TC I have zero. At TC, you're just about taking off from zero, and then these intercepts go towards the saturation value. So this means they're going to go like this. And this branch corresponds to the other part of it. So let me call this M naught to show that it's the remnant magnetization in the absence of a field. So M naught is either this or this, at different temperatures. As I go towards absolute zero, this tends to 1 in the units we've chosen, and this tends to minus 1 out here. The reason we call it a continuous phase transition as opposed to a discontinuous phase transition is that when you boil liquid here, the density changes discontinuously. There's latent heat given to the system, and there's a discontinuity across the order parameter. But that discontinuity disappears as you get to the critical point. In exactly the same way, this intercept for M naught starts off smoothly from the origin and goes up. But it's zero outside the ferromagnetic phase, in the paramagnetic phase. But in the ferro phase, it starts from this point. It doesn't jump suddenly. And then it goes up. And that's the other branch going down here. Now you could ask, suppose I looked at these intercepts for small positive values of the field. I do not switch off the field. I keep it very small and positive. Then out here, of course, you would have for large thing, you would have for this field, you would have this much magnetization. As you lower the temperature, you're going to get more and more of it. And you're not crossing any discontinuity or anything like that. Any point. So this would in fact start like this and go up like that. It would cannot be more than the saturation value, therefore it saturates. On the other hand, in a perfectly symmetrical way, on the negative side, it would do this. As you come down in the field to zero and then go towards negative fields, the magnetization jumps discontinuously to this point and goes here. So you have a jump from here to here. And then it goes further down. Okay? So there's no coexistence region here. This region doesn't, because what happens essentially is that the free energy, if you plot the free energy, will have an unstable minimum, unstable extremum at that point. Since we're going to talk about Landau theory, let me say that right away. If you plot the free energy, the corresponding free energy, F, as a function of M, magnetization, then in the so-called paramagnetic region, this is in the absence of an external field. So F, a function of M, H, T, and now I set H equal to 0. Since at H equal to 0, the only stable solution is 0 magnetization for T greater than Tc, and that's a stable thermal equilibrium state, this free energy must look like this for T greater than Tc. Okay. On the other hand, when you come to this point here, the critical region, this free energy, you still have 0 as a solution, so it gets extremely flat in this fashion. In fact, the leading term starts with the fourth power rather than the second power. So it's not a parabola, but it's got higher derivatives of 0 as well. And when you come down below Tc, it does this. That's the way this parabola with the single maximum, single minimum, it breaks up, finally it degenerates into a curve which is not a parabola anymore near the origin, but a fourth power starts, and then for T below Tc, even below Tc, this higher order minimum splits into two minima and a maximum in between. Okay. This is the M equal to 0 solution that's unstable. So you see, this becomes unstable, this solution. But you have two stable minima as solutions. They correspond respectively to this point and this point. Since this happens smoothly and continuously as you cross Tc, it's called a continuous phase transition. There's no discrete jump, finite jump in the value of the order parameter, the magnetization. Pardon me? Yeah, this is at H equal to 0, so it must be M. Plotted it at, pardon me, well, okay, I'm being a little loose here. In principle, what happens in Landau theory is that you write it as a function of the thermodynamic variable phenomenologically, and then you say the thermal thermodynamic equilibrium state corresponds to an extremum of this F. So I've written a functional as a functional of this M and said that the minimum is at the average value that you want to have. Okay.
So that's why the M naught shouldn't be there.
Yeah, so that's why I put an M there, right?
No, what I meant is that at the minimum you can draw a vertical
line. Okay, I mean,
because you have,
yeah, I know. I should put expectation values or something. We'll do that. When we need it, we're going to be careful with our notation. Okay. All right, so those three figures and these three figures are sort of one-to-one correspondence. Today what we'll do quickly now is I want to show you that this is a square root type of singularity. That is, this curve here, in this region, the m is like the square root of t minus tc. Okay, exactly the same thing in this case, parabolic in this case. Then I want to show that this graph here corresponds to the reduced pressure being a cubic function of the reduced volume. So remember, I already defined P minus PC over PC equal to P, and V minus VC over V equal to V in a little abuse of notation here. And I said in this region, focusing on this region and expanding it, it looks like this. VP let's just write modulus, okay. Cubic curve. I want to show exactly the same way that at this critical isotherm, I'd like to show that H is proportional, is it goes like m cubed on this critical isotherm, the curve that goes like this. 3 is a critical exponent, and I want to show that in both cases, okay, especially in this. All right. Now, the point about critical phenomena is that these exponents, this 3, this half, which we've still got to establish, we'll also establish that this is not the correct formula, that you will get a susceptibility which goes not like 1 over t, but 1 over t minus tc. So this is going to be changed to something which goes like 1 over tc minus t, this quantity, as you come down from the paramagnetic region. There's an exponent 1 here. In exactly the same way, the analog there is the compressibility. That will also diverge on this graph like 1 over t minus tc. Okay, in the critical region. Now you could ask one question, which is what happens to the compressibility as I go from below TC, below the critical temperature? Well, nothing much happens there, it still diverges at that point. The question is, can I define a susceptibility in this case at all? Can I define, because the function is discontinuous. Remember, it's defined in this fashion. So just to get it clear, I'll just draw 3 graphs now. In the para phase, you had no problem. In the critical isotherm, you had this. And I said that it diverges. It blows up. It should, because this is not linear. It's a cubic curve. So the slope becomes infinite at that point. But below the critical point, my isotherms look like this. The function becomes discontinuous. Can I still define a slope and a susceptibility for it? The function is not continuous. Can I define a susceptibility? Why not?
You can't take derivatives.
Why not? I can take a right derivative here, and I can take a left derivative here. Why not? They're not sure if they will or not. But if there's symmetry in the problem, they do. In this problem, there is m to m, h to minus h, there is. Yeah. Yeah. So it's perfectly all right. You can therefore define a susceptibility. So here's an example. If a function has a finite discontinuity, it may still have a derivative at that point. They have a left derivative and a right derivative, and they may even be equal. Okay. So it's perfectly all right in this case. All right. So these are things which we have to deal with now. So what we'll do is, while we have a model here, we need to improve this model. And that's what I'm going to do now. So we're going to take this model here and write it in a more sensible fashion and see whether we get the results we want or not. Now here goes. in all of condensed matter physics, magnetism has always served as a kind of paradigm. Especially spin models have served as a kind of a basic fundamental paradigm for various modeling all sorts of phenomena. And among them, the simplest model is the so-called Ising model, which has served as a model for not just magnetism but binary alloys plus a whole lot of today a huge number of physical phenomena can be modeled by the Ising model. Okay. But I'll try to motivate it in the simplest manner possible. What you start by saying is that if you apply an external magnetic field on a system of magnetic moments, these moments would try to align along the field. Lowest energy configuration is along the field. But in addition to that, the moments may be interacting with each other. Okay. What's the simplest interaction between two magnetic moments? So if I have a moment mu 1 and a moment mu 2 in this fashion, you have to ask what's the potential energy of interaction between them. Now this is not a trivial matter, because this is going to depend not only on the distance between them, these are point dipoles. So you must imagine their physical extent is actually atomic in size, so it's very small. But it not only depends on this thing here, but it also depends on the relative orientation of mu 1 and mu 2 with respect to the vector joining them. And you got to construct a scalar. Now one term in that scalar, if you remember from electrodynamics, would be of the form mu 1 dot mu 2 over r cubed. And then there's another term which goes like mu 1 dot r mu 2 dot r divided by r to the power 5 with a different coefficient. So in general it's a fairly messy quantity. But we are now concerned about the situation where you can only point up or down. Nothing more than that. We also want to ask what leads to magnetism, what leads to ferromagnetism. On the face of it, it looks like this kind of interaction cannot lead to ferromagnetism, because when you have two dipoles, this and this, the north pole, north pole, they would tend to align like this, because that's the lower energy configuration. So on the whole, when you average, you're going to get zero, because plus and minus would just cancel out, right? So dipolar ordering generally tends to be towards a state of zero magnetization, antiferromagnetism at best, certainly not ferromagnetism. The origin of ferromagnetism is much more subtle, and this is what Heisenberg discovered, one of his biggest discoveries. He discovered that purely due to the fact that electrons are fermions and obey the Pauli exclusion principle, when you bring two atoms together, their electronic clouds would tend to repel each other. There's a statistical repulsion. And you can now ask what happens to the energy levels of this combined system here. Then you can write down, after a lot of rigmarole, an effective Hamiltonian which tends to favor under suitable conditions a parallel alignment, which is a purely quantum mechanical effect. It's called the exchange interaction. And this exchange interaction depends on the overlap of wave functions of electrons belonging to neighboring atoms, if you like, and depends on other details of the system. There are situations, there are some substances for which the ordering tends to be anti-parallel for lower energy, but in most of the ferromagnetic substances, it's always plus up here. So essentially, an S1 dot S2 kind of interaction with the minus coefficient, which tells you that the parallel ordering is favored, leads to ferromagnetism. Okay. It is not a direct dipole-dipole interaction, because that's classical, that's long range, it dies down in this fashion, etc. This exchange interaction comes about because if you have one atom here with an electron which has got a wave function like that, and another one here with an electron like this, this overlap integral leads to that effective so-called exchange constant. Since these are bound electrons, the wave functions die down exponentially with distance. So this interaction which leads to ferromagnetism is a very short-range interaction. essentially acts only on nearest neighbors in a lattice, for instance. It's exponentially short in range, but that suffices to produce long range order. In a big crowd, if each person acts, if suddenly one person starts looking in one direction and he or she can only affect his neighbor and he starts looking this way too, then this short range interaction can spread over the entire crowd and soon everyone gets aligned. So short range interactions, if sufficiently strong, can lead to long range order. Okay? That's an important lesson, and that's what happens in ferromagnetism. So to cut a long story short, in our model, in the Ising model, the Hamiltonian looks like this. Now we start writing a Hamiltonian, then we write a free energy and so on and so forth. So we assume that the system is on some kind of lattice, for example. So lattice with sites labeled by I, J, etc. These are site labels. And we're only interested in the magnetic properties, so I write down only the magnetic degrees of freedom here. I write the Hamiltonian only as far as the magnetic moments are concerned. That's all that we're concerned with. So the Hamiltonian H is equal to minus, I put an external field H, and then a summation over I, let's say SIs are the spins or moments. From now on, I'm going to get rid of this mu, little mu. I'm going to subsume it in whatever parameter you. So this is going to be a pure number, which I'm going to take to be plus or minus 1. The mu has gone into this out here. The temperature is going to come out externally separately. So all that has been done, and I've chosen proper units, etc., etc. So it just makes the notation much simpler. So I have this minus, this is a, under a uniform magnetic field H across the entire lattice, minus a term which describes the interaction, which has nothing to do with the external field at all. And we are interested in ferromagnetic ordering, so that's minus 2 summation J, which depends on two sites at a time, the spins of two sites at a time. So I and J, J, I, J, the strength of the interaction or overlap integral depends on this I and J out here, and then an SI, SJ. Since I've assumed only one direction of magnetization, one axis, everything is a scalar here. Otherwise, I'd have to put vectors, this would be operators, then you have a quantum mechanical three-dimensional problem for the spins, which would be horrendous. We are now doing just what's needed, the essential part of the physics as far as magnetism is concerned, for our purposes at the moment. Okay. I will assume that each SI equal to plus or minus 1. And I'm going to take traces. Now, if I have n of these spins, then since each SI is plus or minus 1, I have 2 to the n possible microstates. Whenever I say trace, I mean trace over all the possibilities. Okay? And of course, we'll put in the Boltzmann factor very shortly here. This thing is called an exchange integral. And I already said that since this is a quantum mechanical effect, and the interaction range is very short, I and J have to be nearest neighbors, otherwise you don't have an interaction at all. That's generally denoted by putting a bracket like this. This means I How many nearest neighbors do you have on a line, on a linear lattice? 2. What about a square lattice? Well, a square lattice will have 2. So if this site has a nearest neighbor, 1, 2, 3, and 4. A d-dimensional lattice, hypercubic lattice, 2D. In three dimensions, you have one on top, one below, one behind, one front, etc. You have 6, so you have 2D nearest. Whatever it is, it's a finite number. That's very crucial. It's a finite number. Otherwise, you're finished. You'll see, as in a second, you'll see that's not true. You're finished. Why do I say that you're finished if it's not true? Because you take the expectation value of this guy, you have to average over all the sites, over all possibilities. This fellow will tell you, for a given value of this jij, if both are plus, it gives you a number 1. If both are minus, it gives you 1. If one is plus, the other is minus, it gives you minus 1, etc. And you have to add over all these things. But the point is, if this is summed over all I and j, 1 to n, capital N, and this is the interaction, some fixed number, let's suppose that it's the same number, no matter what the range, what the distance between I and j is, then you see it's clear that this term is of order capital N squared. Because I pull out the j outside, it's some finite number, I have to sum over I and j, and it's going to be of order capital N squared. That violates extensivity. This has got to be linear in the system size. Okay. So an infinite range interaction with the same interaction strength is going to finish you off. It has to drop down. It has to drop down. So that's not even a thermodynamic system. Once I put nearest neighbors, there's no problem. It's a finite number. I go one step further and say this guy is a constant across the nearest neighbors. In other words, this interaction is the same as this, is the same as this, is the same as this. Everywhere. And what's the job? The task is to say, oh, this whole thing is put in a heat bath, and I'm going to find the partition function is trace e to the minus beta. This trace stands for saying that the set Si is equal to plus or minus 1. Every Si takes values plus 1 or minus 1. And I have to find this whole thing. Now, why is this such an impossible task? By the way, you can do this in one dimension on a linear chain with some suitable boundary conditions. But you can't do this in higher dimensions so easily. Even if you switched off this field, you still can't do it in higher than two dimensions. Okay? In 1944, Onsager solved this problem of finding this exactly for this problem without this on the square lattice. That's a tour de force. It's a very, very complicated proof, but now it's a standard proof. It's a long derivation, but it can be done explicitly. And then the idea is to find out what happens when the number becomes infinite, n becomes infinite. As long as n is not infinite, you can't get any singularity. Because remember, oh, by the way, I should also say the free energy is minus k Boltzmann t log z. And then once you have the free energy, all thermodynamic quantities can be computed. Their variances, everything can be done in equilibrium statistical mechanics. What's the complication? The complication is this. Because you have that interaction, you have to enumerate all possibilities. The possibilities of this will affect what happens here. But the possibilities of this will affect what happens here, and therefore here, and so on. So it's an extremely complicated problem, and there are very, very few exactly solved statistical mechanical problems. This is called the two-dimensional Ising model. No one has succeeded in doing it with the field present. And no one has succeeded in doing anything beyond two dimensions. In three, no one knows how to do this. It's probably not doable in this form anyway. Okay. Now, our task is going to be much simpler. We are simply going to argue that each magnetic moment in the ferromagnetic phase will see an effective magnetic field due to the fact that all its neighbors tend to be aligned in the direction of the field. Okay. So this term is going to be replaced by an effective term. We want to eventually find the expectation value of this to find the internal energy, because that's the expectation value of the Hamiltonian with respect to this weight function. The expectation value of this is essentially the magnetization, what I called M. So let me write that down. Definition. In the units I've chosen, I put mu, I've subsumed it inside this constant, inside the field, etc. So it's the magnetization per particle, which is just this quantity here. The internal energy will be the expectation value of this guy, which is expectation here and then expectation here. Okay. So the problem will arise because we don't know how to compute this expectation. The M comes out here, and by the way, this is independent of I, because in an infinite lattice, every magnetic moment is the same as every other moment on the average. But you have this quantity here. And that's bad news, because it's correlated. So what this assumption of mean field theory does is the same as the van der Waals approximation in the gas case, is to say that this thing here, if you look at a particular site I look at this particular site I, then J runs over all its nearest neighbors. And as far as this is concerned, I can replace this Sj here by the expectation value of this Sj. So if I make that approximation, then and then I take expectation values. But of course, there's nothing to take expectation value here because it's already an average. It factors out in this fashion. Okay. What has been the effect of that? The effect of that is to write this as equal to minus summation I some hi si, an effective field at every point, the minus sign, where hi equal to the external field plus j times summation j equal to nearest neighbor of I sg. So essentially, it's as if I put this spin here in a field which is not only the external field H, but also the internal field due to the fact that these guys have got a magnetization on the average. So it's been put equal to Sj here. So it adds to the external field, some effective field. This is called the molecular field approximation. This is the old famous Weiss molecular field approximation. It has changed this field to this. But now we can go further. We have already said J must be a nearest neighbor of I. So let's put in, let's say we are working on a d-dimensional hypercubic lattice, because one of the things that we learn in critical phenomena is that things are very sensitively dimension dependent. How many spatial dimensions are you in? The effect of thermal fluctuations depends very sensitively on what dimensionality you are in. And we'll see that in one dimension, no ordering is possible because thermal fluctuations destroy this order completely. In two dimensions, it is possible in these class of models. As you go in higher dimensions, it gets more and more possible. Okay. So the power of thermal fluctuations or quantum fluctuations for that matter to restore symmetry and stop ordering gets lower and lower as you increase the dimensionality, because the number of neighbors increases and tends to order the system. Okay. See, all of phase transitions is a competition between the disordering tendency of entropy and the ordering tendency of the internal energy. Okay. So you have F, this is with just a heuristic argument, you have U minus TS, this will tend to order, that will tend to disorder, and the competition between the two will decide the minimum of F that you are at. At low temperatures, sufficiently low temperatures, this is low and you win. and the system has a minimum controlled by the internal energy. On the other hand, at sufficiently high temperatures, that wins and you have a disordered state. Okay, so that's really all that's happening, but that's saying it in very, very bare bones. The rest of it is a matter of detail to work things out, but it's worth remembering this. So what does this become? There are 2D nearest neighbors and each of them has the same exchange constant D, J, and this is M itself. So this is equal to H plus 2D J M. This much. H, yeah, but it was for each side, so H effective. Now let's go back and put this in our model. Okay. By the way, I wrote our model down by averaging the value of mu up and down using the Boltzmann factor. We could have written a partition function for it. Each of them has a partition function e to the beta mu h plus e to the minus beta mu h. The partition function for the full system is that to the power n. That quantity is twice cosh beta mu h to the power n, and then I can take the free energy minus n kt log z and form thermodynamic quantities. We could have done that too. So for instance, you have z equal to e to the beta mu h plus the magnetization M equal to, it's after all a Legendre transform. Remember that you have the free energy which has a minus SDT, minus a VDP or PDV depending on which free energy you're talking about. Since we're using H as the control parameter, we're using P, it's the analog of the Gibbs free energy. So there's going to be a minus MDH. Precisely. So I want you to take this guy and show that this is turns out to be tan hyperbolic. Exactly. I just argued saying that if it's up, the magnetic moment is mu. If it's down, it's minus mu. We took the average with the Boltzmann factor and did it directly. But you can go through the rigmarole here. By the way, this is helpful because we can write a formula for the susceptibility, which we are going to use. So chi t equal to delta m over delta h at constant t and zero field, and zero field. So we can write it from this. We can write one more thing. This is equal to minus 1 over n delta m over delta h. So the susceptibility cannot be an extensive variable. It's like a bulk modulus or something. Can't depend on the system size. This fellow is an extensive variable. That's why I got an N here, which gives it. This is an intensive variable, the field. Okay. Like I promised, the second derivative of a free energy would always be some response function, in this case, susceptibility. We're going to use that in a minute. So we have this, and now let's put it back in our equation of motion. So it says, purportedly, m equal to tan hyperbolic mu over kt h plus 2djm. That's our magnetic equation of state. This is our van der Waals equation, if you like, in this mean field theory. First order of business, let's find out what is TC in this. Let's find out what's the spontaneous magnetization. So spontaneous magnetization, what are those intercepts? M naught is given by tan hyperbolic 2d, hey, I got rid of this h mu. I subsumed it in this in my notation, if you recall. So let me write it as 1 over kt. So tan hyperbolic 2dj m over k Boltzmann t. M naught. I put h equal to 0. By the way, this is an equation which is a transcendental equation. You got a power of m here, an algebraic function, you got a transcendental function. So you can't solve it in explicit closed form, only numerically you can solve this. But we can solve what happens when h is 0. Those are those intercepts in the m versus h graph. Well, it's equal to this. And the question is, does this thing have any solutions or not at all? So let's plot both sides. So I plot M naught. The left hand side is M naught itself. The 45 degree line. And this one is a tan hyperbolic guy. Now the tan hyperbolic has a slope. Tan hyperbolic x goes like x near the origin. So it's linear near the origin, saturates to plus minus 1. And two possibilities arise. One of them is that this graph looks like this, then the only solution is out here. But if the slope at the origin exceeds 1, then the graph would look like this. And then you have one solution, two solutions and three solutions, depending on whether the slope is greater than or less than 1. So you have M naught equal to 0 is the only solution as long as the slope at the origin, which is 2dj over k Boltzmann t, is less than 1, or t greater than tc, which is equal to 2dj over k Boltzmann. So we found a critical temperature in this problem. As you expect, it's got to be proportional to the exchange constant J. The greater this is, the higher the temperature at which disorder will set in. And it depends on the dimensionality through the number of nearest neighbors. If you have more of them in a higher dimensional lattice, even at a lower temperature, you would still have order. Okay. Now it's easy to show that these two solutions correspond to precisely those minima I showed in the free energy curve, and this corresponds to an unstable root here. Okay. So we have our first formula, which says TC is this guy here. Now we put that back here, so I can write this magnetic equation of state as equal to tan hyperbolic h over k Boltzmann t plus, now 2dj over k Boltzmann is tc, so m tc over t. And now you see what happens as you lower the temperature further and further. This, as you lower the temperature, this slope guy goes up more and more. So these points are moving further and further away. And that's exactly what happens when you plot this M naught versus T. They start at this point, but they move further and further out towards plus 1 and minus 1. So this is our equation of state. This is like volume, this is temperature, and this is like pressure. But the equation of state says P equal to something or the other. So we'd like to solve for this and see what does this thing look like. I want H as a function of M and T. That's not hard to do. So let's write that as just one more line. And then we'll resume from here. So this is equal to tan hyperbolic H over beta. Let's just call it, H over K Boltzmann T plus tan hyperbolic M TC over T divided by 1 plus tan hyperbolic H over. Just use the formula for the tan hyperbolic of A plus B. And then let's, so this is equal to M. So let's solve for this. It says tan hyperbolic H over K Boltzmann T times 1 minus M tan hyperbolic MTC over T. This guy moved this there is equal to M minus tan hyperbolic. Okay, that's the solution. So you have so H is tan hyperbolic inverse of this whole mess. Okay. Let me see if that's correct. 1 minus M tan hyperbolic, that's okay. And then that's equal to M minus tan hyperbolic. Yeah, that's okay. All right. So now we are interested in the critical region. We're interested in exactly what happens at the critical point. Now I'm going to stop here, but I'm going to tomorrow assume that you've already done this algebra. So show that as you approach TC from below, show that it goes like a square root out there. Then on the critical isotherm, that you can do very easily by putting TC equal to T. Then all this goes away and you have to show that H is proportional to T cubed, M cubed, the second one. With maybe a different coefficient. So all you have to do is to solve this self-consistently in each case. Okay. Now what this means is that the susceptibility will look like this. Chi T versus T, and this is TC, the susceptibility. It diverges at TC. Okay? So we'll start from this point.